give us information that makes our life in harmony with all existence.
Thank you. నేను మరుస్తాను
షేర్ అయింది సార్.
Welcome back, everybody. I hope you all had a nice lunch. We'll start the afternoon session with Dr. Ravi Shankar, Controller of Examinations, to give you orientation on the examination pattern and all other nuances of examination. Over to Dr. Ravi Shankar.
Can you hear me? Yeah. Good afternoon. Hopefully, I will not send you back.
Yeah, I'm going to give you a brief introduction about the examination process, which you need to understand, because the examination process which you have seen so far until you are intermediate is different from the what you're going to see in the next 4 years. Okay, so I'll just briefly give you a brief overview about what this coursework will be like. Generally, coursework is, as you know, distributed across 4 years. Okay, first thing is, earlier if you have a subject like mathematics or physics or chemistry, you get some marks, and then you know that those are your marks in the, that is your score. Okay, but now in engineering degree, what we do is, for each course or for each subject you appear or register for, or you write the exam, you earn some credits. So each subject is, considered as a number of credits. Okay, so your each subject will have some credits. If you look at this, English, if you pass, okay, you get 3 credits. If you pass mathematics 1, you get 4 credits. And similarly, if you pass applied physics, you get 3 credits. So each subject will have an associated set of credits. Put together, there will be 20 credits here. Okay, your complete coursework is divided into 4 academic years. Each academic year is 2 semesters. So put together, you will have 8 semesters coursework. In 8 semesters coursework, in each semester, whatever you subjects you pass, put together, they will be considered as 20 credits. So 1 semester, you will have 20 credits. 8 semesters put together, you will have 160 credits. Okay. So if you pass all the subjects, you get 160 credits. If you are unable to pass any specific subject, then obviously you're going to earn less than 160 credits. If you want a BTEC degree, you have to earn all these 160 credits. If without these 160 credits, you will not be eligible to get the BTEC degree or engineering degree. Okay. And second thing is, your coursework is for 4 years. So obviously you should complete that coursework within 8 academic years. Those who are studying, joining today, that is in 20, should be able to complete their coursework by 2028. Otherwise, you will lose your degree admission also. So in India, there is a rule, any course or any program should be completed in double the number of years maximum. A 3-year degree should be completed in 6 years. A 4-year degree should be completed in 8 years, etc., etc. More than 8 years, you will lose the admission also. Okay. Now understand, in this college, we take attendance very seriously. And one should put up, or one should attend 75% of the classes held in the college. Failing which, you will not be promoted to next semester. That means you are going to come back to college the next year and attend the same semester in which you are unable to acquire requisite minimum attendance percentage. 75%, less than 75%, you will not be promoted. That means your 4-year course now has extended to 5 years. Okay. And similarly, there is one small allowance, a 10% allowance. A 10% allowance on medical grounds or some other unavoidable reasons. So 65 also sometimes is acceptable, but below 65, you are out. So 75% attendance generally is advisable, and 65% sometimes, not every time. Every time you come back to us and ask, I have 65% attendance, please promote me, we will not accept this. Okay. Then each subject, you will have some internal exams, internal marks and external marks. Okay. Internal marks are for 30 and external exams are for 70. Okay. And these internal marks, you will have to write 2 examinations of 25 marks each, and another 5 marks are for assignment. Okay.
Hello.
Another 5 marks are for assignment. And external examination, you should get, examination will be held for 70 marks. Put together, for each subject, you have 100 marks. Clear? Now, if you want to pass, you should get a minimum of 25 marks in the external examination. 35% of 70 is 24.5. So, rounded up to 25. You should get a minimum of 25 marks in internal examination. And internal, external put together should be minimum of 40. Simple. I get 25 marks in internal, 25 marks in external exam, 12 marks in internal, 12 plus 25, 37 marks. I didn't get 40. I'm going to fail. I got 30 out of 30 in internals. I got only 24 in the external examination. Though I get 30 plus 24, 54 marks, I still fail in the examination. So you should get a minimum of 25 marks in the external examination. Out of 70, you should score at least 25. And your internal and external put together should be a minimum of 40. So one component also, both components you should actually concentrate on. And 5 marks will be given for assignments. Okay. Now, you have those marks, no? We will not award marks to you. What we will award here are the grades. What are these grades? These grades, we call them as letter grades. Okay. If you get 90 and above marks in internal, external put together in the examination, you get O grade. And that O grade translates into 10 grade points. Okay. And greater than or equal to 80 and less than 90, you get A plus. You get 9 grade points. Like this, if you get below 40 marks, you get a fail grade. So your marks will put you in a set of brackets. 10 points, 9 points, 8 points, 7 points, 6, 5 and 0. Okay. Now, what exactly does this mean for me? What happens is, what happens here is, I'll go to the one. Yeah, now look at this. Madam, why am I getting this? Yeah, you know, I think it's okay. This is disturbing me. Okay, Rodlin, you got 5 minutes. Now, suppose I have attended for English examination. Out of 100, I got 82 marks. So, if you look at this 82 marks, means I get an A plus grade in this subject, English. Similarly, in mathematics one, let us say I got 95 out of 100. So I get a 10 grade points in this subject. So for each subject, you will not be given marks. Just like your 10th class, you will be given a grade. 10, 9, 8, 7, like this, up to 5. Only thing is, in the 10th class, what they did was, they have taken the average of the 10, 9, 8, etc., whatever you scored in each subject. What we do here is, suppose you got 10 in English. English has 3 credits. So, 10 into 3, 30. 9 into 3, 27. 10 into 4, 40. And then maybe an 8 here, 8 into 3, 24. Like this, the grade points you got multiplied by the credits allocated for that subject. I'm going to multiply all of them. And I'll take that total. And I'll divide it with the number of credits available in that semester. Now, in this case, it is 20. So, take the grade point multiplied by the credits allocated for the course. So, sum of all these credit points and grades divided by maximum number of credits for that semester will give you something called SGPA, semester grade point average. That is your score for that semester. And it will be on a 10-point scale, okay? So, what happens is, in your 10-point scale, you get some value between 10 and 5. Because you need at least 5 to pass, and you get maximum of 10. Not more than 10, obviously. So, between 5 and 10 you are going to get a grade. Okay, and every semester you will have such SGPA. Average of all those SGPAs is going to be your CGPA. CGPA is your final score across all the years together. Okay, so look at this. This is a simple mathematical formula. You will be able to understand this. Number of, if you take one particular semester, credit points into grades in that points, all subjects put together divided by credits for all the subjects put together is going to give you SGPA for that semester, and all semesters put together will give you the CGPA. Okay, and that CGPA, if you want to translate it into marks, CGPA minus 0.5 into 10 is going to be your marks. Suppose you get 6.5 as CGPA. So your percentage of marks, equivalent percentage of marks will be 6.5 minus 0.5 into 10, that is 6 into 10, 60%. Which also should tell you, unless you get a CGPA of 6.5, you are not going to get a first class. Okay. And another small feature which I want you to concentrate here. Suppose from this subject, applied physics to engineering workshop, two students have got 10 out of 10. Okay. From applied physics, from the this point till 8, 3 to 8, two different students have got 10 out of 10. Okay. Now, student A has got 10 in English, 9 in M1, mathematics 1. Student B has got 9 in English, 10 in mathematics 1. Now, if you look at this comparison, this credit point into grade point for all these things are same. If you look at this, but student A, 10 in English, 9 in mathematics. So, 10 into 3, 30 plus 9 into 4, 36. Student B, 9 in English, 9 into 3, 27 plus 10 into 4, 40. So, he gets 67 here, whereas the other student gets how much? 30 plus 36, 66. So, overall, the students, student B, who has got higher grade in M1, will get better score and better SGPA than the person who has scored better grade in English. Why did this happen? Because the subject mathematics 1 carries higher credits over English. So, the person who has scored better in a subject with higher credits will obviously get better SGPA, in other words, better percentage or better score as it is. So, it's not sufficient to, you know, score the highest points. It is also sufficient to see that you get maximum points in courses or subjects which carry higher credits, because the credits are going to decide certain times. Sometimes, you know, they are going to decide certain these things. And then next thing is, till now you never had the problem of getting promoted to next semester or next year, but here you are going to have some constraints. As I have shown you, first year will have first semester 20, second semester 20, 40 credits are there. Okay, if you want to go to second year from first year, if you want to gain eligibility to be promoted to second year, then you should get at least 50% of those 40 credits, that is 20 credits. You should be able to earn at least 20 credits from first semester and second semester of first year to be eligible to go to the second year. Okay, that is 50% of the credits. But from second year to third year, you should earn at least 60% of the credits. End of the second year, you will have 80 credits. For every semester, it is 20. So, 4 semesters are there for 2 years. 80 credits are there. So, 60% of 80, that is, you should be able to get at least 48 credits. That means you should be able to pass in such subjects that you know the sum of those credits is at least 48 to be eligible to be promoted to third year. From second year to third year, your promotion is not automatic. You should be able to get these credits. And similarly, from third year to fourth year, again, you should earn 60 credits. End of third year, you will have 120 credits. So out of 120 credits, you should earn at least 60%, that is 72 credits. Unless you earn 72 credits minimum, you will not be eligible to go to the enter the final year. Understand, entering the final year doesn't mean you know you get a degree. Unless you earn all those 160 credits, you will not pass or you will not get the degree. And somebody must have told you about your hall ticket numbers. So everybody will get a registered number and you will be known only with those registered numbers for the next 4 years. And your registered number is a 10 character long string. Okay, the first two characters denote the year of admission for you. So all of you will get a register number or hall ticket number starting with 2020. And then next two characters are college code. R1 is the Geetanjali college code. Every college will have a code. So this is R1. 1A is the type of course. 1A is 4-year BTech course. There is something called, you know, some polytechnic students will come and join in the second year. Their course code will be 5A. 1A will be MBA. So this 1A actually tells you 4-year BTech course. These two BB together will tell you what branch you belong to, what is your branch. And this last two numbers only are your number, serial number in your class. Okay. That means a first year computer science and engineering student will have a hall ticket number like 20R11A0501. A mechanical engineer will have 20R11A0301 because mechanical code is 03, ECE code is 04, and similarly 12 is the IT code. Okay. And there is only one feature I wanted to tell you other than this. Actually, it comes under this punishment for malpractice, these rules. Okay. This is something I wanted to tell you because as a controller of examinations, I deal with students only in this part, no other place. In the examinations, you will have malpractice. When malpractice means people bring a cheat, people bring some other material, people bring material in cell phones and then copy it, etc., etc. So many malpractices will happen. But one thing I can tell you is carrying a cell phone into the examination hall by itself is looked at or is considered as malpractice. Because most of the students in their engineering, they carry all their textbooks, notes, etc., etc. in their cell phone. If somebody mistakenly carries his or her cell phone into the exam hall, obviously all the exam material will be there in their cell phone. Now, what we will do is, do you carry any material? If that material is relevant to, I mean, if you carry some material, carrying cell phone is a crime. So you will be punished under malpractice. That subject will be cancelled. If the material you are carrying pertains to some question in the examination, then you lose the complete series. That means you will have to write that complete examination series again. Now, everybody carries a cell phone. Everybody carries notes in those cell phone. So we will not bother whether you have really copied or not. You have a cell phone. In that cell phone, you have the notes. And that, I mean, there are some questions pertaining to that notes in the question paper. And that is enough for us to cancel your series and debar you from the examinations. All this is for what? Mistakenly carrying the cell phone into the examination hall. I keep telling people every academic year, at the beginning of every academic year, I will keep telling people, don't carry your cell phone to the exam because this is what is going to happen. still people keep bringing the cell phone inside exam hall. At least when you bring the exam, you know, cell phone into the exam hall, leave it with the invigilator. When you are going back, collect your phone from the invigilator. That also people don't do. They keep their phone in their pocket and they go to the exam. And some invigilator will pull out that phone from his pocket and that fellow will lose his series. Once I found phone with you and material in the phone, I will not listen to any excuses from you that I didn't copy from this, I didn't do this, I didn't do that. We are not worried about it. Because I cannot distinguish, you know, intentions and then, you know, actions. When I find something irregular, I'm going to debar them. Simple, straightforward procedure. So make sure never, 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 ever carry a cell phone into the examination hall. I keep telling people, but they keep doing this, committing this mistake. At least your batch, when you go to exam, make sure that you don't carry a cell phone into the exam hall, because cell phone will invariably will have your notes. You will write the notes and take a photograph of it, and then you may have kept it for reading in the bus. You may have kept it for referring later. You may have kept it for any purpose. I'm not worried about it. Material is there with you. Okay, because what happens is you have studied the content from the material. So obviously that's what you're going to write on the answer script also. Now, how do I know whether it is copied from the cell phone or you have just written it after learning from the cell phone? I don't know. I have the cell phone with you. In that cell phone, the content is there. The same content is there on your answer script also. Now you will say, I have learned it before the examination and I have written it. Because I have learned it, the content looks same, but I will not be able to distinguish between the two. So you are going to be debarred. Make sure never carry cell phone into the examination hall. Okay. Now, if anybody has any question, I'll answer. Otherwise, I'll stop here.
Kindly type your queries in the chat box. I repeat.
Can you send this PPT to us?
This PPT.
I'll send a more complex PPT. I'll send a better PPT. This is, you know, I've been jumping for fourth and back. So I'll send you a better PPT. Okay.
Are cell phones allowed in the campus?
Pardon?
Are cell phones allowed to the campus, generally to the campus?
Not yeah, cell phones are allowed to the campus. Nobody objects. Not to the exam.
What does the LT mean in the box?
Pardon?
What does the LT mean in the box? LT.
Where?
LT in the box.
Ekkada?
How do you conduct first semester in this pandemic?
Pardon?
How do you conduct first semester in this pandemic?
We conduct the regular examinations just as your seniors are writing. Your seniors are writing examinations right now in the campus. You know, we keep 8 feet distance between two students and then they come and write the examination and go.
Explain CGP again.
See, it's very simple. Let us say, look at this slide. In English subject, I got 70 marks. So I get a what? 8? 10, 9, 8. I get 8 grade points. Okay. So the English subject carries 3 credits. So 8 into 3, 24. In M1, let us say I got 10 out of 10. I got above 90, so I got 10 out of 10. So I get 40 here. Fine. So this is 24 plus 40, 64. Let us say I get 9 here. 9 into 3, 27. 64 plus 27 is 91. And let us say here I get 10 out of 10. 91 plus 20, 111. Let us say I get 9 here, 27. 111 plus 27.
178 divided by 20 is roughly 8.9.
Okay. So my LGPA in this semester is 8.9. Next semester, I get 9. Okay. So what happens now? Up to second semester, my LGPA is 8.9 plus 9 divided by 2. So 8.9. Okay. Third semester, I get 9.2. So 8.9, 9, 9.2, 10 average of the 3, I get that is my SGPA. Fourth semester, I get some other SGPA. So average of the 4 is my SGPA. CGPA at the end of fourth semester. Like this, all eight semesters I will have an SGPA. Average of those SGPAs is my CGPA. Clear?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
We move on to Professor Somashekhar Rao, Dean Students Affairs. I welcome sir. Sir will be orienting us on issues related to general conduct and discipline. Welcome, sir.
Yeah, good afternoon. Are you able to hear my voice? Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, yes.
Yeah. Good afternoon to one and all, my dear students. My name is Professor Somashekhar Rao. I am the Dean, Student Affairs in this college, and I want to just brief you some of the points related to student activities. Most of the points in this, whatever I'm going to say, they already came out in the morning by different, the speakers, and also by our COE just now. However, I am going to give some more additional information in this regard. So the screen also, I think it is getting shared. Am I right, madam? Vijayabhaskar garu?
No.
It is not getting shared.
Raavatle, sir. Screening raavatle.
Raavatle, no. 1 minute. Has it come now?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
As a Dean Student Affairs, I want the following activities I am supporting, and I want to explain one by one. The first one is the student's discipline. Student discipline, we'll discuss it later because that requires many points. The next one is the taking care of anti-ragging. You know, ragging means, the senior students, they will do some teaching and other problems to the freshers. But luckily, because of this corona pandemic, you are not going to be in direct contact with the seniors. And hence, I feel that this type of problem will not come at all in this year for you. But I want to tell you that our college is a ragging free college right from this starting year. No single ragging event happened in the college till now. It is completely ragging free college. Okay. Next one is the conducting extracurricular activities. In addition to your co-curricular activities, your curriculum, as per your classwork, there will be many such extra curricular activities also will be conducted. These are all fests like some WIBGR, WIBES, Alpha Medica, Pressure Day, Freshers Day, etc., etc. So I request all of you to take active role in these activities also, based on your interest, and you can demonstrate your skill in these activities. WIBGR means it is a annual day. WIBES means it is the day just before the annual day, like a function with music and other things. Mm-hmm. Alpha Medica means it is a technical fest. Like that, so many activities will be conducted on a regular basis in the college. The next one is the NSS activities. You know, NSS means National Service Scheme. It is the scheme of the government of India and also state government. And we are actively involved in this NSS activities. There is a coordinator, and there are faculty are there. Faculty are there actually involved in this one. And we encourage students to participate in these activities. So the social, what are the different types of activities that we'll do? We'll adopt the nearby villages. We have adopted almost 7-8 villages, which are very nearby, and we will support in the growth of those villagers. We primary education in, for example, the primary education, the primary schools in and around the college, our students will go there once in a week, just for 2 hours, 3 hours, they will give lectures. They will give lectures there. The lectures can be the, what I can say, present today social problems, and then the new English language and like that. Also, we are... Some noise is coming. Other one is the Swachh Bharat. Keeping the, as per Government of India, we are keeping the environment clean, not only in the college, but also in the nearby villages. We'll involve the villagers, we'll involve the school children, and we ourselves, we'll involve ourselves and make the environment clean around the college and also in the nearby villages. And also we are doing a lot of employability creation. We are creating employability to the villagers, mainly unemployed. How? We are giving some special training, technical training. We are giving the office, Windows office, so that they can work as a data entry operator. And then we are giving them like skills like tailoring, like that. That also we are.
Their colleagues and Maria students.
Also, we encourage our students to go to the villages to find out what are their problems and give solutions. That also we encourage. The examples are, for example, the pollution. There will be something like, you know, air pollution, water pollution. So how much is the pollution? Whether that water is drinkable or not. If not drinkable, what to do? That type of advices we'll be giving. Also, you know, how to measure the land. Then what is the soil? The soil testing, like this. And also we are using the database management in the villages, so that we know how many are educated, what is the health of the various villagers, and then how many are employed and unemployed. All those data we'll collect it, and based on that data, we'll give suggestions and we'll involve ourselves to improve their conditions, their position. Also, we conduct many health camps in the college and also in the villages, like blood donation camp, dental camp, and then general health camp. Like that, we'll arrange and we'll supply, for example, if eye camp is there, we'll supply freely the spectacles and the medicines. Why I'm telling these things is that, all these things, those who are really interested in doing this type of service, you students, please actually participate in these activities and help the society, help the nearby villagers to get better benefits. That is why I am talking about these NSS activities. Next one is, we are having a good library, and we are having so many, what I can say, all the textbooks are available in the library. Each student can take 4 books at any time, and it is a spacious one. And also we are having the digital library. where a lot of e-books are available. And also we are having a computer center where you can go and work there. You can generate your own files, your data. You can get the internet. From the internet, you can download the information. That computer center is there. Also, we are having two PDs, physical directors, for the sports and games. And we are having indoor games area. And outside also, we are having a lot of courts are there for doing this one. We conduct the inter-college, intra-college, and universal level competitions. We encourage students to participate in these games and sports. So what I suggest is those who are interested in these games and sports, once the college physically starts, you can give your names to the PDs, and then you can take the active role in that one. So then we are having a healthcare center also, a full-time nurse is there, and also a doctor's on appointment, it is available. The next thing is that we encourage the toppers. The toppers means the rankers. So those who are having the, those who are top in the class, we encourage them. How do you encourage? They can get additional books from the library. Instead of not only standard four books, they can get another three, four books extra in the library. They can purchase books and that amount will be reimbursed. Certificates will be given to them as a topper. And at the end, if the college level toppers, scholarships, a special cash amount will be given those who are at the college level toppers. Like this, we encourage the toppers. And also, a lot of alumni activities will be going on. You may not be directly involved in these activities at present. After 4 years, you will become alumni. Alumni means the student who has completed the studies and then gone out. Those are known as alumni, the excess students. So we are having an alumni association registered. And each year, we will have an alumni meet. And continuous contact will be there among the alumni and also with the alumni and the college, continuous contact will be there. So these are some of the topics. Then I will go to the discipline level. Any problem related to students' activities in the college, you may contact me or any HOD or principals or others. So first one is the discipline. Discipline was talked in the morning. In the very well, right. And once you are a disciplined student, discipline is not only in the college, and it is also in your personal life in the office, everywhere you have to maintain discipline. If discipline is not there, then many problems you will face. So automatic discipline will give hard work, sincerity, loyalty, dedicatedness, integrity, honesty, decency, punctuality, like that. So in the college, in the GCET, some rules are there. I want to tell you about the rules. Already these points are discussed to some extent. In the morning, Chairman Sir also has said about the dress code. Some parent has asked and he has said those things. So I will go through that one. The student should wear proper dress in keeping with the decorum of an educational institution. Wearing T-shirt without collar or with some slogans, text and pictures printed on them, are wearing jeans with a lot of holes, pockets, like that, they are not allowed. And also in the laboratories, special restrictions will be there, like wearing aprons, shoes, etc. These are all for protection purpose. Maybe in the chemical laboratory, chemicals, shoes are required, where items should not fall on the legs, like that. So that is the dress code. Regarding the ID cards, identity cards will be given to you. Every student should wear the ID card and display it continuously in the buses and also in the campus. What is the purpose of this one? This indicates that you are the student of this college, you are part of this college. Outside, we can identify who are the outsiders, who are the real students here. And also, if any student forget to bring the ID card, he can register in the main gate and he can come. If he lose the ID card, he can get it, a duplicate ID card by paying a prescribed fee. That can be done. Next one is the punctuality. You have to come to the class in time. In the morning, if the college starts at 9, the main gate will be closed at 9. That means those who come late, they will not be allowed into the college. Up to the first period is over. Only for the second period onwards, they are allowed. The reason is, if we allow continuously for the first period, for every 2 minutes, 3 minutes, one student will come, try to enter and disturb the class. That is the reason why the gate will be closed in the morning. Also, the canteen also will be closed in the morning from 9, once the first period is started, and also after lunch from 1 to 1:30. The reason is, you have to go to the classes in the morning in time. Similarly, after lunch, you have to go to the class in time. That is why the canteen is also closed during that time. Then, regarding the buses, in the buses, the student has to travel in the bus only by payment, only with a valid bus pass. So, and also you have to display the ID card indicating that you are the student, and you have to board only in the allotted boarding point only, not somewhere in the middle, and should not get down somewhere in the middle like that. But also, you have to take the seats as per the bus in charge instructions. Each bus will have a faculty as a bus in charge. So the bus in charge will observe the, what I can say, the indiscipline, if anything going on in the bus. So if you lose the bus pass, you can get a duplicate bus pass. And you should not make too much of noise in the bus. Not that very strict, absolute silence. It is not like that. But at the same time, you should not make your passengers to feel discomfort because of your behavior. That decency is to be what I can say, to be maintained. Regarding the mobile phones, frankly speaking, mobile phones are not allowed into the college, but because of some emergency requirements and contacting the parents or something like that, they are allowed. But they are strictly to be in switched off condition in the classroom. No phone should ring, or you should not talk in the classroom while class is going on. Also, in the exam hall, already our COE has informed you, if you find the phone itself with you, that itself is a, it is indiscipline. So similarly, in the lab also, laboratory also, we should not keep the phones. Otherwise, what will happen? The phones will ring, making a lot of noise, and it will disturb your fellow students. That is the regarding the mobile phones. Then, under some more instructions are that no photographs of persons or buildings are to be taken in the campus using your mobile phone. And then the safety of the phone is your headache. You know, the college will not take responsibility. We'll lose a phone. And if you say that I lost that so-and-so cost, means what college can do? Not only phone, your other valuable things also, please take care. We have got internal, surveillance, that is cameras, CCTVs are there. We kept them. But these TVs may not, observe each and every corner and may not identify this type of activities. So that is the, and personal belongings also, please take care of yourselves. If you lose your cash or your, gold ornaments or something like that, what college can do, it is your responsibility. Okay. And while driving vehicles also, it is, traffic rules. And we observe number of times, it is two-wheeler is for three, like that you think. Two-wheeler is not for three persons. Two-wheeler is only for two persons. And also, helmet is a compulsory. Similarly, cars means car belt has to be kept. You know, so many accidents are going on. And that too, you, in young age, you may feel thrill by going high speed with many persons like that. Don't do it. Your lives are very precious. So that is the regarding this one. And if you want to leave the college in the middle, you cannot leave just like that. The security personnel will not allow you to go out just like that. You have to take a movement slip, the pass, which is signed by your department. And if you hand it over at the gate, then only you are allowed to go out. So that slips, movement slips are required for going out. And not only if you come on the holidays also, you have to take in advance permission for entering the college. And seating in the classroom also, you should not sit at the last bench and like a groups. It is not like that. You should spaciously, you have to sit. Of course, again, due to this corona, nowadays, all of you are going to sit like that only, but that is another restriction
for all of you.
then attendance is already told by COE to you. And discipline committee members are there. Members they go around, and if any indisciplined activities are observed, action will be taken. And I want you students also, if anything is going on wrong, if you observe that one, you please bring to the notice of your mentor or your HOD or to any of us, so that the type of things will not happen in the campus. Okay. If it is any serious, indisciplined activities there, no, without any mercy, they will be sent out of the college. So these are my points that I want to tell you. If you have got any questions, you can call me.
Please type your queries in the chat box.
Any questions? I'm not able to see.
College timings, as of now, we are going online, and the class academic classes will begin from Monday.
Hello. Hello. What is the question, ma'am?
Sir, anything dress code for women, sir.
Dress code? What is the
for women?
For girls,
for ladies, girls.
For girls, the dress code is that sleeveless dress is not allowed, and decency is required. That is the only restriction. Okay, not shorts, not sleeveless dress on the tops.
Thank you very much, sir. Next, we have Professor Hari Kumar, Dean School of Electrical and Electronics Engineer, to update us. Welcome, Hari sir.
Thank you, madam. I hope I am audible to all of you.
Yes, sir.
Respected parents, dear colleagues, and my dear students, a very good afternoon to all of you. At the outset, let me extend to you a very warm welcome.
Sir. So 1 minute, Hari sir. Somashekhar sir, can you stop sharing the screen? Somashekhar sir?
Yes, yes, I'm trying to do that one.
Yes, unfortunately, yes.
It's okay, madam. No problem. I will continue. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Warm welcome for the evening session of today's orientation program. This is surely a special day for all of you, as today you're going to start a new and fresh journey of your life. Life with full of new challenges, milestones, and achievements. This day is a day of nostalgia for many. It is a day with many mixed feelings of happiness, confusion, fear, and excitement. But do not worry, we are here for you to make sure that your journey of 4 years in our college is effective, efficacious, memorable, and productive for all of you. We wish to bring out the best in every one of you and prepare you to become competent enough to meet the global challenges. But remember one thing, be proactive. Push yourself, because no one else is going to do it for you. Also remember that the way you're going to spend your life in the next 4 years is going to decide your future. Relax initially and repent for the rest of your life. Or the other choice is work hard initially and relax for the later part of your life. The choice is yours. You are the creator of your own destiny. In fact, I do not want to talk much about the departments, because every department in the college is complete in all aspects in providing the academic resources to the students. The good number of doctorates, the innovations in teaching that we adopt, the meticulous mentoring of students that we follow, the encouragement that we provide to the students in bringing out their creativity through the innovation cell, the rigorous training being imparted to improve the coding skills, and the other kind of training that we provide to boost the employability skills of students, the centers of excellence that provide special kind of training in the core areas are only a few of the myriad number of academic practices that we follow, which provide the right kind of academic ambience for the students to become successful in their life. In fact, the accreditations by NAC and NBA, the autonomous status granted by UGC, the certification from ISO, the recognitions from CSIRO and MHRD reflect the kind of quality that the institution is maintaining ever since its inception in 2005. Now, let me briefly explain some of the best practices that we are adopting. The first thing is innovations in teaching. Teaching nowadays has become more student-centric rather than a teacher-centric ever since the outcome-based education system is introduced. Earlier, teaching was carried out as per the perceptions of the teacher without any specific outcomes. It was a one-way transmission, and it is more like a rote type of learning mechanism in which the students were made to memorize the topics and they have the habit of reproducing in the examinations, irrespective of whether they have understood the concepts or not. Students were made, in fact, passive listeners, but now with outcome-based education system being practiced in the college, teacher has to think what extra skills that he is providing to the students at the end of each period of lecture. The outcomes are very well defined. The autonomous status of the college is providing the flexibility of framing the curriculum and the syllabus as per the needs of the industry requirements. The second, thing that we are following is the project-based learning. In fact, there is a popular adage, if I hear, I forget. If I see, I remember. But when I do, I understand. So this is very much pertinent for higher education system, so that the students are able to imbibe theoretical concepts by performing related experiments. In fact, let me give a better clarity on this. It is something like if I keep on watching on TV how Tendulkar bats, that doesn't improve my batting skills unless I practice on my own. Similarly, you can't learn how to drive a car by watching others driving a car. What is needed is you have to experience that, you have to practice that. Project-based learning is a similar kind of thing. Learning becomes more easy by way of experimentation and experience. Making use of all the concepts that you study in a course, if you can design and come out with a product for the real-world applications, that is what is known as a project-based learning. Throughout the college, this project-based learning is being practiced since last 2 years. Now, there are so many other things also that we are following, but because of the time constraint, I'm just limiting to these two. Now, let us come back to the students' world. You must be having so many thoughts hovering in your mind or lingering in your mind, something like, why did I take this branch? What am I supposed to learn? Will it be difficult to get a distinction in engineering? In what way will engineering be different from the intermediate education? Probably most of you might be having several questions with regard to the skills that you are supposed to acquire and the strategies that you have to adopt to become successful and finally getting a placement before you leave the campus. Of course, you don't have to worry at all in this aspect. If you are proactive and exhibit the right kind of attitude to learn, you're going to be successful. Now, let me give you a few suggestions that ensure success. It is something like, suppose if somebody says that he has one medicine that will get rid of all your health problems, including corona, what we do? We are going to gulp it immediately. Similarly, there is one mantra that takes care of most of your academic problems. That is actually very, very simple. It is being regular to the classes. This may not sound convincing to most of you in the first instinct, but believe me, this solves 80% of your problems. Do not effort to miss even a single class. I will tell you the reason also. In engineering, most of the topics are interrelated. It is something like, if you miss out today's class, you're not going to understand and follow what is taught in the next class. So as far as possible, unless it is warranted, you attend the classes on a regular basis. And the second thing is, be inquisitive. In fact, in Telugu, there is a movie, I do not remember the name, but Enduku, Emiti, Ela. So these are the 3 points. That is what is needed to understand and assimilate the intricacies of a course. Let me give you an example. You all know how to operate a mobile phone. In fact, I know most of you operate the mobile phone very effectively, better than all of us. That too, even without going through the user manual. Can you please tell me what is the reason? The simple reason is you try to explore the different possibilities of using the mobile phone. And that you don't mind, in fact, experimenting with it. A similar kind of thing is required in studies also. If you adopt a similar kind of strategy in studies, you're going to become a master. Do not, in fact, my appeal to all of you is, whatever the teacher says, don't accept as it is, unless you're convinced. For getting convinced, you've got umpteen number of ways. Now everything is available. You can, in fact, go through the internet and then get your doubts clarified, and finally you can get convinced. So this is the only way to learn the subject. And then regarding how to study, this is also one important aspect. Studying just before the internal examinations or the external examinations is not going to help you in learning the subject. Study regularly, probably 2 to 3 hours per day. Do not study for the sake of getting marks. In fact, I strongly believe that marks should be a byproduct of your learning. Concentrate more on your learning, automatically marks you're going to get. Your learning should be on a gradual note. It is something like you should not look for an abrupt progress. You should look for an incremental progress. In fact, you can't become an expert overnight. Okay, Rome is not built in a day. For example, if you want to go to a place, something like which is 1 kilometer away, of course, without taking the assistance of any vehicle, we don't jump there. You walk step by step, you walk steadily. Probably it takes about 10 to 15 minutes to reach there. And even if you run, probably you're going to take 5 minutes. You have to live with that. But if you try to jump, you definitely get hurt. Similarly, learning should be a step-by-step process. You can't become an expert overnight. In the process of learning, do not compare yourself with others and undermine yourself. That is not correct. What progress you have made since yesterday, since 1 week, since 1 month, that is what is more important. Finally, the most important skill that every one of you has to imbibe is English communication skills. Perhaps this is the most important quality that you need to imbibe to get placed, especially if you are looking for a placement in IT sector. Without this, whatever knowledge you might be having, you will be summarily rejected. It is something like a car without any engine. Irrespective of how much of decorations you make, how many additions you make, it is of no use. Similarly, unless you have a beautiful communication skills, whatever may be the subject knowledge you might be having, it is of no use as far as the placement is concerned. A student with better communication skills will be in fact more confident and can be very easily convince others. In fact, he can convince others very easily. So practice speaking in English right from day one onwards. Read English newspapers, converse in English only. Do not mind even if you make some mistakes in the process, because as long as you are a student, you can afford to make mistakes. Okay, everything is will be in fact forgiven. But once you join any job as an employee, you can't afford to make such kind of mistakes. Okay, so this is one particular point I would like to in fact force upon everyone. As long as you stay in the campus, develop a habit of speaking only in English. Okay. So with this, I take leave from all of you. I wish you a memorable and eventful professional life ahead, all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Hari sir, thank you very much. We move on to a short orientation on Fine Arts Club. And this is a very important part of this orientation program. According to JNTU and AICTE, it's mandatory for the colleges to conduct student orientation program in creative practices. And for this, the Fine Arts Club and the college has planned this way. Before that, I would like to share with you why creative practices. Am I audible? Can you hear me? Thank you very much. Creative practices relax us, they invigorate, they build, we learn team building, and then they teach lessons for life. And I would like to share with you what actually these creative practices are and the plan also. In this college, during these 10 days, we would like to encourage you to paint, sketch, clay model, perform dramas, take short films, and take videos of dancing or videos of your instrumental music. You can sing and take a video, or beatbox. Sorry for the error there, beatbox. You can mime and do some mimicry, or quilling, and then digital art. Any one of these you can do, and then send a soft copy of it. Now, what the actual plan is? The actual plan is, today will be, the Fine Arts Club is announcing, I don't know whether we can call it a competition actually, but we want to make this as a celebration, and the celebration starts from today. In case you have, you know, a penchant for art, for any art, or if you are skilled in any art, we want to see how strong you are in that area. From today itself, start recording, or if you want to paint something broadly on the pandemic theme, if possible. Otherwise, there's no restriction. And then first thing is, we'll be sending you Google form link for you to participate. It's a very simple Google form. You have to enter your email ID, the admission number, the branch and section. And then we'll be dividing the Google form into columns, and you'll have to select in which you have to, art form you want to participate. And then, there's no restriction. Actually, you can create a new painting right from today itself, or you can submit something you have already done. Okay, So when I say submit the soft copy of it, we want you to click a picture of it and send the image with high resolution and with good clarity. And we want you to submit this by 12th December 2020. We may think there's a long time, but then time flies like that. So start working on them and submit your digital work or any images, whatever it is, to the following mail ID, the one that's displayed on the screen, fineartsgcet007@gmail.com. Now, the next question definitely is, ma'am, should we be very proficient? I mean, should we be very experts in those fields? It's not at all necessary. And I want to make it very clear that this will be for the love of art. This will be for each other, to know each other's skills so that we may know your skills and you get engaged in the most beautiful form, the art form. Once again, I would like to share with you what are all the aspects you can work on. You can paint or display the old paintings, or some of you can form small groups. You know, friends, all of you, if you have joined this college, you can form small groups and then come out with a mime or solo mimicry, beatboxing, and you can come out with a drama, or you can play instruments, take the video and send us. When you're sending the video, we want you to give a very short description. You know, your name and basically name and then branch and all those things in the word form. It will be easy for us to record. And once again, I would like to tell you, we're not talking about prizes here. It's about love of participation so that we'll have a relaxing time. And the submissions would be, as I said, on 12th December 2020. And after receiving all your contributions, we'll be displaying all of them. We'll make a collage book and then an album of it. And then we'll be displaying on the last day of the orientation, that is 12-12-20. That's a Saturday. Quick doubts? Anyone? Yes, photographic. Yeah, you can take part in more than one event. How many hours online classes will be conducted from morning to evening 5:30? We said with two breaks and one lunch break. We'll be having one break in the morning, one lunch break in the afternoon, and another break. And 3:30 to 5:30 will be the orientation classes from Monday. Yes, you can send as many contributions as possible. There's no restriction at all. But the thing is, your contribution, in case it's a video or audio, the most important thing is the clarity. And if it is an image, the resolution is very important. And what about books? Your respective teachers. See, you'll be having classes from Monday. Your teachers will get to you. Your mentors will inform you what books to buy and bring. And then laptops. Can you bring laptops after the classwork, offline classwork? One more query. Offline classwork, I repeat, will begin once the university takes a decision. Till then, we'll be having online classes. Freshers' Day will be conducted once we meet each other. Yes, online also we'll be planning Freshers' Day. I'll share the slide of competitions. The mentors will share. Okay, I repeat, laptops or one desktop is compulsory. Laptops are not compulsory, but you need a desktop for programming. Should we buy a desktop or laptop now? Yes, programming classes start from Monday. So you take a call on that. Online classes will begin from 9 o'clock on on Monday, academic online classes from 9 o'clock to 5:30. Tomorrow we'll be meeting at 9:15. Please register, please log in by 9:15. The classes will begin at 9:15 tomorrow. Any length of the video doesn't matter. In case you're taking a mime or mimicry or a drama, I think length should not matter, but the content should matter and the clarity of it. Okay, thank you very much. And we'll be meeting. All club coordinators will be meeting you in this while, and you can get your doubts clarified at that time. I repeat, buying of laptop is left to you. But you need either laptop or desktop, that is computer system for programming. Yes, you can use systems in the college. The laboratories are open for you. Thank you very much. We'll join by 9:15 tomorrow. And remember, attendance is mandatory. Thank you very much.